first and foremost, I'd like to say a great welcome to our baptism family today, to Molly and to Tyler being baptised. It's a great pleasure to have you with us. Everything you need for the service, in terms of the words we speak, are in the service book, including the readings. And there are two more hymns that we sing later on in the service, and the hymn numbers you'll find actually in the service book just when we're about to sing. So keep an eye on your service sheets and you won't be lost at all. You will get a chance to move with us when we go to the font, which will come after this sermon, but I'll make that clear at the time. Secondly, this is Homeless Sunday. So we have that theme running through our thinking today in our sermon and in our prayers too. So we remember especially the homeless. And last but not at all least, we are relaunching Junior Church this Sunday, and we're just going to give a few practical announcements.
Yesterday marks the long-awaited return of Junior Church. It's experimental two-week return. It's an experiment because we're doing something slightly different from last time. So we'll be starting in church, so we're going to church, we're going to work, we're in the hall, we're going on, we're starting in the church, and then we're going to go out with the children's video people after the glory and the collect prayer, but before the readings, so just a bit it says, and now at least after the readings, that's when we'll go out, so and I'll be at the back, we'll go to the hall, and then sort of stay for the rest of the service, and then we'll all go down, get the coffee, we'll be there waiting for you. Just one final administrative thing. If you are planning your children to attend the Junior Church, you haven't filled out all these yellow registration forms, then if you put your hand now, I can pop over and give you one of the 10 questions since the station you are. yes. Back there. Really, I'll just go over and give you those. Enjoy the rest of your service.
So we certainly finish the problem. Let's still our hearts and minds. We pray together the prayer of preparation, which is at the bottom of page 1 of the service book. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires are open, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, I am your brother, you have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, in negligence, in weakness, in our own deliberate thought. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
mercifully grant thou to our Holy Spirit, may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So we sit now for our readings, and we wish our junior church members a happy and interesting morning.
Job answered his companions, "Today also my complaint is bitter. His hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come even to the throne. I would lay my face before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatest of his power? No, but he would appeal to me. There, an upright person could reason with him, and I should be acquitted forever by my judge. If I go forward, he is not there, or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left, he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. God has made my heart faint. The Almighty has terrified me. If only I could vanish in darkness, and thick darkness would cover my face. This is the word for me. John Screenhower. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him, no creature is hidden, but all our mortals in their affairs, the eyes of one, to whom the strength and count. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. But we do not have that high priest who is able to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested to do well, yet has been without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of hosts with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. This is the word of the Lord.
Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace of God. their baptism, to celebrate with their parents this week, and today, and with all of our parents, just to remember your name, sorry, me, Christopher, Amy, Titus, Kelly, and Josh. So welcome, and I will speak a little about you again for the sermon. But we have to celebrate something else. We have to commemorate something else today because it's important. And Philip has already referred to it. It's Homeless Sunday. It's the one Sunday of the year when we reflect on the homeless and we think about what the situation is for them and what we can do about it. And we're rather privileged here in St. Mary's because we have amongst our congregation someone who is the chief executive of Housing Justice, church charity devoted to it. And I've asked her, Kathy Home, if she'd come up and join me and talk a little bit about homeless and about housing justice. I've got a microphone too, which I think is going to work. Do a good test.
Hi, sir.
Oh, good. I'm not sure I need to get some help. Kathy, thank you very much for coming up. You're here and you want to use the opportunity of your people just to learn a little bit about what you've got to believe is your place in justice.
Oh, well, so St. Mary's, as you know, Mark, but not only the you know, has been running a night shelter for, or something like that, for the best part of 20 years. And I joined as a volunteer as somebody who works in housing and supported housing services. And housing justice supported us to run a night shelter. That's how I found out about housing justice, and that's what spurred me to.
Well, thank you. Well, that's great that you did that. Just to help us a bit, can you tell us a bit about homelessness? What it's like to live in this? What the numbers like in London and elsewhere?
Okay, so there's three types of homelessness, really. The first one is obviously the one that's the one that's really visible. Competition to us, that's the one that's really visible. You see people bedding down in doorways, and so we're all aware of that. So, what are the numbers like on my sleeping? There's an annual count every year, and when it was done last autumn, there was 2,688 on the streets of England. However, we do know that to be an underestimate. And during the government's initiative to bring people in off the streets during COVID, there were around 20,000. So we need to take that figure with a pinch of salt. What we do know is that it's really rough on people to be on the streets, and average age of death of the man is 47 and the woman is 43, so shockingly young. Then we have what we call statutory homeless, and that's where the government through law has imposed an obligation on local authorities to house people who become homeless. And pretty much that's families with children, nobody else needs that bar. And the numbers are quite horrendous there as well. So last year, with the last statistics, we've got not much shy of 300,000 families picked up in this way. Trouble is, we're in a housing crisis, so where do the local authorities put them? Very often in really poor quality temporary accommodation. And any one time we've got around about 95,000 and rising families, so there's not individuals in various forms of temporary accommodation, single room, bed and breakfast, old offices, containers, most unsuitable. And you think of the impact that that has on children's education, on their health, it's really shocking. And always think that's what's happening in our country. And then the last category we talk about, the incident homeless, what it says on the tin, we don't see them, but there'll be people living in squats, in and out of hospitals, maybe friends putting them up for a bit. We don't have numbers on those, but we know that some of those will be included in that 20,000 that went into hotels since last year.
Thank you very much. So what does housing justice do about this?
Okay, so I'll tell you my mission statement, so I think summarises what's quite an unusual organisation pretty well. So our mission is to mobilise Christian action on homelessness and poor housing through love, justice, advocacy and nurture. And I sort of emphasise the love because you won't find that in the mission statement of many organisations, but it's a strong expression of our Christian faith and Christian mission. So we're a sort of second tier organisation, that means that we support the people on the ground to do the important things. So to kind of place that locally, Housing Justice supported St. Mary's when it was one of the pioneering churches to set up the night shelter. Continued to support Devon and Barnett, which is the charity that runs the night shelter. And this year and last year, we've been able to lever in money from elsewhere to provide grants, so quite significant grant. And that's us enabled to get a market to run service out of hotels in individual rooms so that people aren't catching COVID from one another as they may have in large shelters. So we support, that's our largest part of what we do. We have a project called Faith and Affordable Housing, which is about turning church land into affordable housing. And either on our website or going onto the Church of England's website, people look, they'll see it's we've had very strong leadership from the Archbishop of Canterbury about it this year through the Archbishop's Commission on Housing and Community. So watch this space on that, because there's real leadership and housing justice is very embedded with the Archbishop's Commission in terms of turning church land into affordable housing. We have a project that we run directly ourselves, which is we call it our hosting project, and that's for destitute migrants. So people who have failed immigration cases or failed asylum cases, whilst they're in the appeal system, they're not allowed to work and they're not allowed to claim benefits. So they are quite literally destitute. It's like a really archaic word, really, but it's most applicable to this group. So we call those destitute migrants. So what happens to them whilst they're still trying really hard to stay in the country? Well, we have a hosting programme where people give up a spare room in their houses, take them in, whilst we support them and other agencies work for them to regularise their immigration or their asylum status. And we have a really high success rate of those people getting the right to remain. So there are people who are entitled to stay here, but it's quite a system to navigate your way through. And then finally, we're sort of promoting a pilot project, which is about working more with people to support them when they come out of homelessness and then move on into accommodation. We call that our Citadel project. It's about people being their own fortress, finding the strength for them.
Thank you. That's really interesting. Now, can you ask the last obvious question, because we've got to ask ourselves this question. What can we do? What can we ordinary people who have never been to the community or because we haven't took my friend and families back?
Well, the people of St. Mary's and the community environment have long had homelessness in their hearts and should continue to do so through supporting together environment in the way that they have and supporting homeless action environment, which there's this conversation supported through volunteering and financially. It is the only day centre in the whole of the borough for people that the local authority has an obligation for, so it's a really important place. So carry on supporting those in the way that they are. In fact, we've harvested last week and we've worked through the homeless action environment. So that's one thing to do. Another thing is, this is quite a big ask, but if people could have it in their hearts to consider being a host, please talk to me or make contact through our website, no obligation, but we're short of bed spaces now because with people working more from home and with grown-up children returning, then there's less spare bedrooms for people to use for hosting, and we are really short of bed spaces for that very valuable project. I'd say to people also, you know, talk to your politicians, local and national, and make sure that they hold homelessness high on the agenda. Bus sleeping's had a lot of focus in this last 3 years or so, and has indeed in the past. It's not particularly a party political thing, so, you know, both parties have supported it, but make sure that it stays high on the politician's agenda, because we don't want that to slip now that we're out of the crisis of COVID. We proved we could get bus sleepers off the streets into hotels. We don't want to go back and have people sleeping off of this boat. It's not, you know, it's past as well. And finally, pray. I mean, prayer is not available, so pray for those who are suffering, and many are really suffering, and pray for those who are working to support them.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much for coming out and telling us all about that. That's a real good eye-opener, I think, to many of us, what's going on in the business. And at the end, we heard some things we can do, and the things, of course, are the good things that St. Mary's and those can do. Now, today is the day when we lament another group who are special, the Afghan refugees. We all know from the news exactly what's been going on in Afghanistan and what has happened to all those people who had to flee Afghanistan. And we are collecting today, at the back of the church, we'd like to give money, we're collecting for a charity which is putting together a partners to support the Afghan refugees who have arrived here. And what we need is money, apparently there are too many old clothes. certainly. And then just choice it. Go, sell what you own, and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. I don't know how you feel, but I feel rich. Whether or not I start comparing, I do feel rich when I confess that. And if any of you doesn't feel rich, then if you ever get the chance to meet a poor person in a lonely country, as I've done, you'll know exactly what it feels to feel rich. I stood in a slum in my Nairobi, meeting, seeing thousands of people living in that slum and meeting some of them. And it's a truly humbling situation to feel very, very rich connected with as you speak to someone who is very, very poor. And Jesus is talking to the rich. He's talking to a rich young man. And let's try and think a bit about what is going on here. Because first of all, there's a conversation between Jesus and the rich young man. And then there's a conversation afterwards with Jesus and the disciples. And in fact, of course, a conversation between Jesus and the disciples is a conversation with us. The young man came to Jesus. And the first thing to notice is that he knelt in front of him. So he respected Jesus. He wanted something from Jesus. He looked up to him. And Jesus said, what do you want? Because he did want to ask a question. He was going to push for a question. And his background with Jesus he was a good man. He had kept the commandments that Jesus mentioned. And they're all the commandments, if you look at them in the paper, they're all the commandments about being good to other people, how you should treat other people. You should not murder, you should not steal, you should not commit adultery, you should honor your father and mother, you should not be flawed. Those are commandments about how we relate to each other. And he said, I've been keeping all those. Jesus said, I know. But Jesus knew something else about it. The reason he came to Jesus is he knew there was still something missing. And Jesus knew what that was. And he knew it was for that young man's wealth. And he said to the young man, you have escaped the time of quoted, go and sell your possessions and follow me. And that was just too shocking for the young man. It was too much. Because, and you know this for yourself, he was quite connected with his possessions. He liked his possessions. After selling it, going on the road, was pretty shocking. So that was the end of that conversation. But Jesus then sorted through that conversation and his conversation with the disciples. Because the disciples truly were shocked too. They always thought that the rich were kind of first in the queue to get into heaven and to be with God. Because they had the opportunity of following all the rules and they had some money which the leftover rich they could give away and be nice to the poor. So they couldn't see how, if that rich young man was not going to come, how could they? But Jesus came and said to them that if people follow him, which of course the disciples were doing, then they will feel rich. They will feel rich in terms of relationships and the things they need. And they will have a rich relationship with God. And that rich relationship with God is what Jesus was talking about when he talked about eternal life. Heaven, a treasure in heaven. Those are flowery words for a sense of being with God, God being with me and with us, God looking after me, God caring for me in my troubles, God filling me with joy about happy things. It's about having that feeling that God is there as your constant companion and your constant care for God. And that's what's open to all of us. In this life and the next, is to have eternal life. But we have to get rid of our dependencies. That young man had a big dependency on possession. Many people today have that dependency on possession. God is saying to us, we should not have that dependency. Maybe it sounds a bit rich for us to sell everything, but just if we're parents, we've got duties to our children, it's really enough. We've got perhaps duties to our own parents, to the part of them in their own way. We've got some duties, and the idea of selling everything would seem to go against that, yes. So what Jesus is saying is get rid of the dependency. Of course we need money and we need money, but we need to get rid of that dependency. And it's about other dependencies too. So if you do get rid of those dependencies, we have the opportunity of sharing the painting good that we get in with other people. That's the other big message of today, is we have to share with the poor, people who don't have enough. And that, of course, links with our call to support the homeless and our call to support the refugees. But the sharing thing, and this is where I'm going to come back to more of the title, is the sharing thing is about us as a community sharing with our new members. We have two new members today who are joining our community. That's a big thing for us, and we hope it's a big thing for you. And it's a big thing for your parents and for your godparents that they are going to be supporting you in this new part of your life. You're old enough to understand this, which is fantastic. Hopefully, nobody will one day be told what we're trying to say. Maybe you can tell them, you can learn. This is a big thing for you and for your whole group and family and friends. It's wonderful to see lots of you here. We'd love to see people coming to support children who are in that time. But it's a big thing for us too, speaking to St. Mary's, to be the representative of all the ministers around the world who can welcome Molly and Tyler to our midst and care for them. Because as we say, as Kathy said, prayer is part of our way of caring. We will pray shortly for our homeless and we will pray for Molly and Tyler and many other situations. So, now that's the end of our talk today, and we're going to move on to the baptism. Philip will introduce it and tell us what we're allowed to do in these holy times. Unfortunately, we can't do what we normally do, which is hold church, go away to the pond. And heads around there and tries to see what's going on. But do it with us.
Thank you, Nigel. Yes, so we come now to the baptism, and I invite Molly and Tyler and all our family and friends to follow us around to the box. For regular Samaritans, folk, if you stay in your seat so we don't have too big a throng in the soundbite. We make our way across for the baptism. And do take your orders of service with you, because it has been the worst of the need on this section. So if you show them what's come to the front of it, so you can see what's happening, because there's lots to see in a baptism. There's quite a few words, but there's lots of interesting things to see as well. So do make sure you've got a good view of what's happening. And so I invite the whole church to stand up for the baptism. Faith is the gift of God to his people. In baptism, the Lord is adding to our number those whom he is calling. People of God, will you welcome these children and uphold them in their new life in Christ?
With the help of God, we will.
Parents and godparents, the church receives these children with joy. Today, we are trusting God for their growth in faith. Will you pray for them, draw them by your example into the community of faith, and walk with them in the way of Christ? The baptism of these children begin their journey of faith. You speak for them today. You care for them and help them to take their place. within the life and worship of Christ's church. Baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his marvellous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to be our victim. Therefore, in this context, I ask you, do you turn to Christ? Do you repent of your sins? Do you renounce evil? Do not be ashamed to confess the faith of Christ crucified. Fight valiantly as a disciple of Christ against sin, the world, and the devil, and remain faithful to Christ to the end of your life. May Almighty God deliver you from the powers of darkness, restoring you the image of his glory, and lead you in the light and obedience of Christ.
Amen.
Praise God who made heaven and earth,
who keeps his promise there.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Almighty God, whose Son Jesus Christ was baptized in the River Jordan, we thank you for the gift of water to cleanse us and revive us. Saving God,
give us life.
We thank you that through the waters of the Red Sea, you led your people out of slavery to freedom in the promised land. Saving God,
give us life.
We thank you that through the deep waters of death, you brought your Son and raised him to life in Christ. Saving God,
give us life.
Bless this water, that your servants who are washed in it may be made one with Christ in his death and in his resurrection, to be cleansed and delivered from all sin. Saving God,
give us life.
Send the Holy Spirit upon them, bring them to the new birth in the household of faith, and raise them with Christ to full and eternal life. For might, majesty, authority, and power are yours, now and forever. Amen. Saving God,
give us life.
So let us affirm together with those who are being baptized our common faith in Jesus Christ. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and love, the one for whom we exist?
I believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again?
I believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world?
I believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the Church.
This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
I baptize you in the name of the Father, May God, who has received you by baptism into his church, pour upon you the riches of his grace, that within the company of Christ's pilgrim people, you may daily be renewed by his anointing spirit, and come to the inheritance of the saints in glory.
Amen.
So we remain standing as we pray.
Today we give you thanks for the privilege of welcoming Molly and Tyler into the church fellowship. And Heavenly Father, thank you for the freedom we can enjoy in doing this. And together with their parents, godparents, family and friends, we ask for their good health and for their happy and contented family life. May they grow up to enjoy all the good things that life offers, and may they reach their God-given potential. Thanks for the privilege of witnessing their baptism, and may it be a memorable time for their parents and godparents too. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Our prayers extend to our Christian brothers and sisters around the world who are living in environments of conflict, whether it be in war-torn regions like Afghanistan, Tigray and Ethiopia, or other conflict areas like Syria and now potentially China and Taiwan. Or whether it be in environments where natural disasters have meant people have been made homeless and properties damaged and life savings obliterated through floods, fires and volcanic eruptions. Or whether it be environments where ethnic and minority conflicts have meant people have felt ostracized and misjudged and in many instances abused. Mighty God, so often the lack of justice throughout the world makes us angry. Like your prophet Amos, we see the poor being trampled and denied the basic freedoms that we so often take for granted. We pray for all those who are being driven from their homes in places of conflict and forced to seek refuge in Europe, most recently Afghanistan, and also the ongoing problem of migrants from Africa. We pray that member nations of Europe will do their best to offer a safe refuge to those in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our Queen and her government and the desire to rebuild Britain, build back better. And as we move towards ending the pandemic's hold on us, may the choices discussed by our leaders at the various party conferences be made for the benefit of the whole of the United Kingdom, and that they would commit themselves to delivering on social care, supporting jobs, addressing climate issues, tackling crime, and levelling up in Britain, and not levelling down. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray especially for all our students, whether in school, on vacation courses, doing apprenticeships or university studies. Uplift and uphold them as they learn new subjects, develop new friends, forge new relationships, learn to mix with others from other social groups, discovering new interests and being challenged by new ideas. And may they be conscious of your Holy Spirit and his comfort and guidance, which you offer to seeking hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Father, we pray for the sick, whether it's physical or mental. We remember the psalmist's words, "Be not far from me, for my troubles are near, for there is none to help." May they find help within our communities and ultimately in you. And we think especially of the homeless today. Empowering God, you offer compassion to those who are overlooked or forgotten. We ask you to open the hearts of local and national leaders to the plight of the homeless, that through a sense of responsibility and indeed compassion, money and infrastructure will be allocated to help in the short term and provide facilities for homeless across the nation. That safe places can be allocated to them for rest, for sleep, and for showering each day.
Sustain ministry such as our own and offer food, clothing, and peace of mind via the work of the Night Shelter Program. We pray for the partnerships between the local authorities, voluntary and charity organizations, faith and local communities working together to end people's homelessness. And we pray especially for Kathy and her leadership. Finally, we pray for the army of staff and volunteers from our shelter charities across the region who continue to support those who are without a roof over their heads. The Lord be praised. Great is the Lord and most worthy to be praised. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And there's the welcome. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Holy and silent, by one Spirit, we are all baptized into one body. We welcome you into the fellowship of faith. We are children of the same Heavenly Father. We welcome you. We are all one in Christ Jesus. We belong to him through faith, heirs of the promise of the Spirit of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Peace be with you.
And we'll stand for our Eucharistic prayer and say when we get to communion, everyone is a full member of their own church is most welcome to receive communion today. We've distributed communion just one time, just in the bread, and we've done standing, so come down the main aisle to receive the chance to step out of the room and the carpet begins. The hospitable, we would always invite guests to go first, but it's actually, I know, it's quite awkward to be the first person to do, especially in to come forward, especially if it's an unfamiliar space. So, unless you're desperate to be first, I suggest stop some off, unless it varies, we'll just slip way back, don't hold back, do come down and set a good example so that others who are with us maybe for first or second time, say, can follow your lead. So don't wait for the people on the crossroad. Give them a chance by setting a good example. And before receiving communion, there is some hand sanitizer at the crossing lights under the people in the area. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. For your goodness we have this bread to offer, which ever thinking with human hands of made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. For your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, from whom you have created all things, who sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By his power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So that he fulfilled your will and won for you our holy people. And now we give you thanks, because by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a holy people in Jesus Christ our Lord. You raise us to new life in him, and renew in us the image of your glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and to all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising and singing. Saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which you shed for the earth for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me.
Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
So, Father, falling to light his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice may once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom, all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. So we sit or kneel now as we say together in confidence the prayer which our Saviour gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Let us pray. Holy and blessed God, you have fed us with the parting blood of your Son and filled us with your Holy Spirit. May we honour you, not only with our lips, but in our lives, dedicated to the service of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies, to be a living sacrifice. Send us out to the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. At the end of the service, as Nigel said, we're having our collection for Afghan refugees, and a donation basket for cash, and a contactless thing as we move into the 21st century. After this service, and about starting at 12:45 from the church hall, we've got the first of our walking group meetings. So do come and join us if you like, a walk that will start from church and end back at church. So no public transport required then. evening prayers as usual at 7 o'clock on Zoom. Coming up, in addition to the usual services this week, next Saturday we're continuing our prayers for the environment at 9:30, and you might have noticed on the newsletter last week that Craig Featherstone's funeral is at Holy Trinity, East Finchley, and that's at 11 o'clock. So please do attend all of those services. So now let's stand to sing our final hymn, and panically, number 30 in the hymn.
Thank you.
Go in the light and peace of Christ.